episode of Rex Rated R Horror Movie Review Show, where we review all things related to horror, horror movies, horror TV shows, horror documentaries, horror news specials from the 1990s, horror comic books, absolutely everything and anything that has to do with horror, because around these parts, we love that shit. But there's a very special type of horror movie, or horror story, that we really like around here. And that's the kind of story that deals with the Catholic Church. Demonic possession. A creepy ghost in your attic. Maybe a friendly ghost in your closet. Ah, okay. I like that. We could do Casper. And zombies. But not the horde zombies, the slow zombies, Romero zombies. Yeah, the horde zombies are scary. They're too fast for me. They are fast. Anyway, welcome back. Welcome back and welcome. If you're new to our show, thanks for joining us. We appreciate you being here, and we really hope that you enjoy this episode and all the other episodes that are available now on Apple Music and Spotify. If you're a returning listener, welcome back. If you're a returning listener, this one's for you. Well, what about the new listeners? Yeah, all right. If you're a new listener, this one's for you. And a live one. Ah, look at that. Today's special. Oh, yeah, you already gave it away. Today's special is a triple cheeseburger with a mega tub of fries and an American-sized XL Home Depot bucket of Diet Coke. Oh, Lord. Today's special. I just said it again. Good Lord. Oh, you really need to do your exercises now. You did. I do. Oh, now brown cow. Unique New York. Today's episode is a special one. There you go. Now you got it. But again, ever special. Oh, Lord, now I got the problem too. Now you need to do your exercises. Unique in New York. Unique New York. Ready? Yes. But you always say that every episode is special. That's because every episode is special. We're here tonight enjoying life another day. So anyway, today we'll talk about the murder of Jane Doe. And if you're new, then you don't know this, but this is always a spoilerful review of the movie or show or whatever it is that we're talking about. Spoilerful. If you haven't seen The Murder of Jane Doe, then, you know, you can listen to this and then watch that later, but everything will be spoiled. And everything will be fine. If you're not, you already know that. Anyway, we also have a very simple format around here for those who are new. Our format is as follows. I'll talk about the things that I like. Not in general, but things I liked about the film. Then I'll also talk about the things I don't like. And then we'll do a plot review and commentary. And then we'll do a script-accurate dramatization of scenes. But we don't do any analysis because, you know, I'm not an expert. But I think I'm becoming a bit of a demonologist. What do you think? I'm indebatable. Anyway, we also don't do script-accurate. That's also not a fact. Oh, it's a fact. Ah, Lord. And then we'll give this film a rating. So let's get right into it. The Things I Liked is sponsored by no one. I really like that one. The Inside the NBA does that. Yeah, me too. It's funny. The Things I Like. Great story. I mean, a really great story. There's probably stuff out there like this already. Like, I'm sure the morgue and crematorium. They're too scary of places. They're too good to not be used in films, especially horror films. But this one certainly, you know, really well done. Great sound. Great lack of sound as well. I mean, it's not just the ambience, or rather the sound that accentuates this film. It's also the lack of sometimes too. I mean, this is a morgue. This is a crematorium. So by nature, it's probably a little quieter than usual, or, you know, than other places where it's a little more lively. Oh, Lord, now, come on now. Come on, it's joke, eh? Anyway, great sound, or lack thereof. Great music, really, really accentuates the images and pictures we see in the pictures. Yeah, you know, like in the olden days, they would call movies, pictures. Well, you see, I'm starting in a picture, right? It'll be a gangster, right? It'll be a great picture. It'll be the, you know, this picture's going to win an Oscar, right? All right. I mean, I guess you could say pictures. Well, I mean, you wouldn't even call it movie. Talkie. Weepy. Well, what the hell's a weepy? A weepy in the olden days is what they used to call movies that was specifically targeted towards female audiences. I think it maybe it predates the term romantic comedy. Not that other people can't enjoy romantic comedies. I'm just telling you a little bit of history of the film industry. Anyway, great sound, great acting. Now, typically, I don't enjoy when there is unknown actor in a film or known actress simply because I feel like I can't get lost in the illusion of what this is. Well, I already know this guy. He's in that other movie. You know, I don't find him believable here. But this instance is one of those instances where I enjoyed it. The actors are, you know, Emil Hirsch and Brian Cox, and they have tremendous chemistry on screen with each other as the father-son duo who run this Morgan crematorium. And you know what? I thought it was tremendous acting. Great acting by the actress who also played the corpse, who was Jane Doe. It was a really good job there, too. It wasn't a dummy. Are you some kind of dummy? It's not a dummy. It's an actual person. So great job at that, too. Well-used jump scares. There are jump scares in this film. And if you're new, you don't know this. And even if you're not new, I've talked about this before, but not as much. I don't get them. The jump scare, I'm not susceptible to it. I mean, it happens, of course. I'm not saying I'm impervious to them. But it's really hard to get me with a jump scare. I see them coming from a mile away. It's a gift. Sue me. All right? You're going to sue me? Sue me. But really well used. There's more than one, and I found them to be very effective and really well used and not overused. They're just really, really well spread out across the entire film. You like that film instead of talkie? I mean, I guess you could say film, talking, movie. A potentially great origin story for the main character in this film. And I think that it should have been explored a little further, but unfortunately, it just was not. But maybe there's an opportunity for a prequel about that. But, you know, this is also going to be one of the things I don't like. All right, so that's it for the things I liked. The things I didn't like, sponsored by no one also. Oh, Lord. Number one, the ending was pretty fucking bad. If you know anything about anything, Bill, do I like happy endings or sad endings? Oh, you love when the characters at the end of the movie are, you know, the police is arriving, the po-po is arriving a little too late. But they're arriving finally. The sirens are sirening. The sirens are sirening. That's right. The sirens are sirening. And the police is policing. And the ambulance is ambulancing. Wow, thank you for the new verbs. Policing, I've heard. Ambulancing, I've not. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you learn something new every day. Thank you, Billy. I appreciate that. But you're right. I love happy endings. Even when it's a little too much or too little too late for the police show up, the ambulance show up, when it's already basically the evil has been defeated or contained or abolished, whatever the case may be. But I do enjoy that. I don't like the sad ending. And unfortunately, we have a sad ending here. And it's not just sad. It's pretty freaking tragic. Tremendously tragic. It's just sad. It's ugly. I hated it. And I also didn't like the fact that we did not explore Jane Doe's origin. I don't know why. I felt like, you know, you could have shoehorned it in a little bit there somewhere in the middle of the story, at the end of the story, somewhere. But unfortunately, we get nothing. And, you know, I think there's a lot of story to tell there, but we didn't get it. So, shall we dive deep into this one? Yeah, let's begin. All right, so now let's jump right into the story. All right, so now we begin. The movie opens up with a shot, I hope. And we're exploring the scene of a crime. It's a home. It's a multiple homicide somewhere in Virginia, Grantham to be exact. And as the camera walks around, we see the people that the crime scene investigation, right? Yeah, that's the CSI people. And they're walking everywhere around this scene and taking pictures. And, you know, we find a victim, a second victim, a third victim. And right now, we don't know anything about what's going on. But then we reach the basement of this home. And there is the corpse of a recently deceased woman, as far as we can tell visually. It looks like it's recently deceased. And she's somewhat buried. She's half buried from the waist down. She's buried from the waist up. She's not. But nobody knows why she's there. She doesn't have gunshot wounds, as far as we can tell. She doesn't have any stab wounds. None of the things that the other victims are exhibiting. And so it just doesn't really seem to fit the rest of the crime scene. And also, the sheriff, discussing this with deputies, or maybe it's a lieutenant, I forgot. They're discussing the fact that there's no signs of forced entry. So how or why did this crime happen? The criminals were already inside. They did this to each other, or I don't know. But somebody suggests that maybe they were trying to get out. We don't know. So the mystery begins. And then we move on to the next scene. And we see now really, really amazing shots of the Tilden morgue and crematorium. And we see long, long tracking shots exploring the entire morgue and crematorium. I'm going to say funeral home, but I'm not sure if it's a funeral home. What do you think? No, it definitely says morgue and crematorium. And I don't know if they're the same thing. Yeah, I don't think they are either. So there's just long tracking shots showing us an office, the crematorium area, hallways, one of those round mirrors that has spherical mirrors that allows you to see at a specific angles, 90 degree angles, perched on the corner of two meeting hallways where they meet and then form the 90 degree angle. And then we start following some green doors and we enter. We enter the morgue. And inside the morgue, we meet our main characters, who are Tommy Tilden and Austin Tilden. And Tommy Tilden and Austin Tilden are a well-oiled machine. And when we meet them, they're listening to some music and they're performing an autopsy on the charred remains of a man. And these guys are pros. Everything is clockwork. And Tommy utters the dad. All right, Austin. What's the cost of death?
Dad, I think it's... Well, based on the fact that his lungs were really dark, I think it's smoke inhalation.
Ha! Smoke inhalation. Let me tell you about smoke inhalation. Did I ever tell you how I met your mother? Huh? You know I'm from Miami, right?
Yeah, Dad. Yeah, why?
Well, you know, the song that just reminds me of when I met your mother and...
But you said smoke inhalation.
Well, let me finish my story. So then we were at the club and, you know, I was dancing and the song plays. And, you know, just come out of the restroom. I had just done a little coke. Dad? What? It was the 80s. What do you want me to tell you? It's Miami. That's how we did it back then, all right? You gotta live a little, Austin. Come on. Anyway, there I was, and I was getting a drink, and suddenly I see this woman dancing in the dance floor, and holy son of a bitch, it's your mother, and she knows how to move her hip.
Dad, I don't really want to listen to this story. Can we continue?
Oh, come on, Austin. Anyway, there she was, and I start dancing towards her, and all of a sudden we're dancing with each other, and well... Long story short, not before long, you know, we leave this place and then we head back. All right, Dad, I'm going to stop you right there. That's enough. Okay?
Can we just continue with the autopsy?
Ah, come on, Tommy. Austin, you're a grown man.
Dad, I don't want to hear it.
Fine. Tell me. Cause of death.
I already said smoke inhalation.
Smoke inhalation? Try again, motherfucker.
Oh, Jesus. I don't know, he fell and he smoked too many cigarettes or something like that. I don't know, Dad. Can we just not do this tonight? It's kind of late.
Come on, Austin. This is a gimme. Come on.
I don't know that.
Fine, I'll tell you. Look, let's look at the brain. You see that? Huh? You see that?
I don't know. What is that? Plantar fasciitis?
What? Are you kidding me? This guy fell, tripped, hit his head. He died. That's how he died. Maybe he did. Maybe you're right. Maybe he died. Maybe he was that. Maybe he was flat feet. Maybe you're right. Anyway, I'm just going to dance out of here. I got to go get a smoke. I'll be right back.
And he dances away.
He did not dance away. Maybe you saw the different version. You saw the boring version. That's the version I saw. They were playing Miami Sound Machine. Anyway, Austin steps out for a smoke, and then we see those shots of the, you know, those huge corridors, and he's walking through one, and he reaches the staircase at the end of a corridor, and he props open the cellar doors and steps outside, and then lights one up.
Ah, man, the 80s.
And then we catch up as Tommy, Dad, steps out for a smoke. Austin stays in the morgue filling out some documentation for one of the recently deceased, and he's putting a tag on, one of the drawers. And suddenly he hears a creepy noise coming from a vent. And of course he breaks the rules of horror and immediately goes to explore. Grabs a stool or something and steps on it and peeks up, and thankfully not much of it. It's just his cat. Oh, God. Actually, he doesn't creep on it. The cat just comes down with a mouse. Sorry. He drops a mouse and he throws it away. Oh, he brings him tribute.
I bring you tribute, human. Meow.
Damn it. Damn it, cat. Oh. But the noise continues. And so Austin continues exploring. He wants to find the source of this other noise against the rules of horror. Rule number one of horror: you hear creepy noise, you don't explore it, you ignore it. But alas, he continues exploring. So he steps into the office where he sees nothing. And steps back out, turns the lights off,
and suddenly, ah!
Oh, Austin, it's just me. It's Emma, your girlfriend. And it's Emma's girlfriend.
Emma, come on now. I work in the freaking morgue. Like, you got jump scares? Seriously? Nothing of it. Emma has never been there for some reason. But they have a date, and she got tired of waiting outside, so she caught up with them inside. So now they're walking and they're talking, and suddenly we're back inside the morgue room. And Emma says to Austin, "Oh, hey, Austin, do you think I can see one of these bodies? I've never seen one. You know, you never show me your job. You've seen where I work." And Austin's like,
"Well, that's because you work at the library. I work in a freaking morgue, you know, I'm a morgue technician. Who would want to see that?"
Anyway, they step inside and she insists on seeing one of the recently deceased. And Austin tells her, "No. You know, my dad has rules against that kind of stuff. And then, you know, that's rule number one. He would never
let her see one."
And suddenly, Tommy, the dad from behind, yells and tells them, "Yeah, right.
Open up the drawer. Pick one. Which one do you want to see?"
And Emma's like, "Seriously? I can see one?"
"Absolutely. Pick one."
And she picks the one to the furthest left. We're looking at the drawers. And the drawers, if you don't know, it's where the deceased are kept. They didn't know they were called drawers, but that's what they're called. There's room for six. And she picks, and they're divided into two rows of three. And she picks the first one on the left. And sure enough, pull out the drawer, and there it is. The recently deceased body of somebody who has her eyes and her mouth sewed up. And then she notices, just asking questions like, "Wow, you know, that's, wow. What is that? Why? That's interesting. But anyway, what about this one?" Well, that's not enough for her. She wants to see another one, right? "Yeah, I don't know why. that wasn't enough. Like, they open up another drawer for her. I thought that was a little disrespectful, but I mean, humans are very curious. I don't get it. Yeah, definitely. So they close up the drawer and they pull out the other drawer. And this one has a different cadaver. And this cadaver has its face covered with a white cloth. And there's blood all over the cloth. And she's curious. Can I take off the cloth? I want to see what the face is like. And Austin's like, you don't want to see that, Emma. I'm telling you, Emma, that's not something you can unsee. Please just let it go. Okay, but what about the little bell on the foot? And Tommy chimes in. Well, the bell used to be used in the olden days to determine if someone was actually dead or they were just comatose. So call me old fashioned. I like the little bell. Huh? Sue me. Okay, well, I still just want to see that. Can I see the face? I want to see what's left.
Ding, 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 ah!
Emma screams.
Oh, Emma, you're too gullible. I got you with the little bell. It was me. I rang it, not the foot. This damn thing is dead. Did you really think it was the body? Oh, Emma, you children are gullible. Oh, Lordy, Lord. Unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. I can't believe that stupid little thing like this. Anyway, why don't you get out of here?
So they jump scare her with the little bell. Did it get you?
I mean, not really. I kind of saw it coming.
Okay. This one didn't get me either. The one that where she jumps out at Austin was the one that got me. But anyway, as they're about to leave, because they were going to get out of there, well, they gotta make like a train. Why don't you make like a train get out of here? So they were getting out of there because, again, they were going on a date. And they're walking through that corridor that I mentioned earlier, or at least one of. And they reach the elevator. I didn't mention this earlier, but in a long track, long opening shot, we saw a staircase and we saw an elevator. So they're getting ready to get into the elevator. And when suddenly Sheriff Brooks opens the elevator doors and he's wheeling down the body of Jane Doe, who we saw earlier. Now, Jane Doe is that corpse that we saw earlier in the film a couple of shots ago. The one that has no physical signs of trauma, that doesn't look like she's dead, and the one that doesn't look like has anything to do with the other murders that had already happened. But anyway, he wheels her into the morgue where Tommy awaits, and he tells Tommy,
"Hey, Tommy. Hey, I kind of need to know what happened to this Jane Doe, and I need it done by tonight. I'm sorry, Tommy, but the press will eat. They'll chew my ass in a bad way. You know what I mean? Like, not in a good chew, not in a good way. Like, chew my ass in a bad way. In a good way, that's a different story. I'm not talking about that, but I'm talking about when the press chews my ass in a different way. Not in a physical sense. That would be, I don't want to talk about that. But they chew my ass in a bad way, meaning they want answers. And they want answers, so therefore I need an answer. I need you to tell me what happened to this woman, this Jane Doe, and I need it tonight. Tonight, huh? Well, we were just about to close shop, but fuck it. I'll just put some glory on and, I'll give you an answer. Sure, no problem. All right. Well, I really appreciate that, Tommy. Hey, no problem. Absolutely.
And so Austin notices that, now there's more work to be done. And he asks Emma to postpone for a couple of hours because he wants to help his dad. And of course, Emma doesn't like it. And then she brings up the fact that at some point they're leaving, meaning not leaving the night, but leaving in general, as in no longer living in the general vicinity of where the father lives. You mean they're moving? Thank you. They're moving away. And of course, Tommy hasn't told his dad, or rather Austin hasn't told his dad Tommy this just yet. And she sort of leaves a little disappointed, but that does look like she'll be coming back later in the night. Anyway, they need to cause the death by morning. And Tommy and Austin decide, Austin decides he's going to go back inside the morgue to help out his dad. So we reconvene inside the morgue. And they're like, Austin, I thought you had a date. Well, dad, they've willed this thing in. And, what's it going to be? A couple of hours, right? So let's just get right to it. Let's just get done. Do you want to hear some Gloria?
Yeah, absolutely. Now we're going to... Now we're cooking. All right, what do we got? And don't forget the right stuff on the board. Gray pupils, huh? I would expect that from somebody who's been dead for a couple of days. Ha! Put it on the board. No lividity. No rigor mortis. Interesting. Put it on the board. She's cold as fuck. Put it on the board.
Dad, she has a really small waist.
Ha! Small waist. Interesting. Congenital? Maybe. Put it on the board. Broken ankles, broken wrist, but no external signs of trauma. Fascinating. Austin, put it on the board. Ah, look at this. That's Pete. Pete? Yeah, Pete. And it's everywhere. It's in on her nails, on her hair.
Where do you get Pete from?
Well, it grows naturally up north, but around these parts, you'd have to get it at, those places that sell things to grow shit, like flowers. I don't know. Anyway, put it on the board. Huh? No fluids. No foreign substances. Put it on the board.
Austin opens up her mouth.
Huh? Look at that.
Oh, Dad, it looks like someone pulled her tongue out.
You're right, that does not look like it was surgically removed. Put it on the board.
I'd like to make an accusation.
An accusation so soon? All right, go ahead.
Well, she has bound feet, bound ankles, tongue was pulled out. Maybe she was tortured in traffic.
Ha! Maybe. Can't rule it out. Put it on the board. Shall we continue?
That's my producer interrupting. He has a very important message for everybody. Intermission.
All right, let's continue.
Dad, she has a missing molar.
Ha, put it on the board. There's also a string.
Yeah, I found it down her throat.
Put it on the board. All right. Fascinating. Interesting.
And they continue with a vaginal examination, and they determine that she's been cut internally, deliberately. Now shit starts to get creepy and crazy. Now it doesn't look like, normal. Well, not that any of these are normal, but the causes of death are looking really, really intriguing, but nothing solid, no real theory just yet. Now it just looks like this woman was tortured and bound and all kinds of crazy shit. So, the old lively mood of we're just going to get this done in an hour really starts to fade and dissipate here, doesn't it? Yeah, they went from like this clockwork machine where they can just determine everything, like clockwork, to now really being puzzled. So yeah, it doesn't really look like they're having as much fun now. Well, they're more concerned than intrigued. Agree. Anyway, there's some thunder.
Interesting. No signs of external trauma. Even with the wrist being broken and the ankles are shattered. How does that possibly happen?
And then suddenly some song on the radio starts to play. Let the sun shine in on the radio. And really fucking creepy song for no reason. And then they begin the internal exam. And the coroner, Tommy, begins to perform the incisions, the typical incisions that they do to cut up a body in that Y shape. He starts at the top near the chest and cuts downward through her navel all the way through the abdomen and a second one on the other side, so left and the right. And suddenly, she starts bleeding.
Huh? I've seen that, but only in corpses that have been dead for an hour or two. And she's got gray pupils, so she's been dead longer than that.
And Austin's like, well, that's not supposed to happen.
Huh. Fascinating. Put it on the board.
And he continues the internal examination, and now he determines that the small waist is not a congenital condition.
Nah. No congenital conditions here. Must have been a corset.
A corset? Didn't those go out in style when you were, like, young, Dad?
Ha! Good one. Ha ha! Oh, you got a good sense of humor, Austin. Good job. Put it on the board.
And they continue. And now they get a good look at her lungs. And they're black. They're blackened as though she has
had some sort of, you know, third degree burns. But
how is that possible? Third degree burns internally, but no external signs of trauma. Huh? Put it on the board.
Well, I mean, that's the cause right there, though, right? I mean, like, third degree burns, she died in a fire.
How the hell did this woman die in a fire? When there's no external signs of trauma, Austin, it just doesn't make any sense. Not even if she smoked a pack a day for 30 years, would her lungs be this black? Something's not adding up. Put it on the board.
And they continue to investigate, and now they see that her organs also have cuts and scarring. Oh. Maybe? Scar tissue, but from what?
I don't know, Austin, but imagine if all this somehow internal trauma was displayed externally. What would she look like?
Well, Dad, I'm no pathologist. That's your job, but if I was a guessing man, I'd say she looked mangled.
Huh. Fascinating. I agree with you. But why would anybody do something like this? If you want to kill somebody, just shoot them in the head or poison them. Something much easier. Something's not adding up.
So the condition of the body suggests that she just died externally, but all these other crazy things, the clouding is in the eyes, you know, again, suggest that she's been dead for longer than that. Well, shit is just not adding up here, right?
Yeah, I mean, how do you have, like, black lungs like that, but nothing externally? Meaning, if you died in a fire, you'd be charred, you know, you'd be crispy. Like a chicharrón. Oh, you know chicharrón? Oh, I love chicharrón. Which one, the Mexican one or the Filipino one? Oh, I love both. Good answer. Ah, thank you. They're both delicious. Yeah, I mean, it's not adding up. They see trauma internally, but nothing externally. How is she even dead? She doesn't look like she's dead on the outside. Yeah, you're right. So they're puzzled. But they continue.
And now the radio station again mysteriously switches. And now Austin is starting to see things in the hallway. He thinks he sees... Well, he sees a shadow or something. And he goes to investigate because I think maybe he thinks it's Emma again. And as he's investigating, now he climbs that stool and finds, while exploring, investigating the air conditioning duct, his cat, or the dad's cat, actually turned out to be his mother's cat, who, by the way, has passed away. And it's mangled, like it's just been hurt. And Tommy walks in the room because Austin falls.
Ah! What the hell? Damn it. Damn it, Austin. You're so clumsy sometimes, you know? You really remind me of, well, myself. Anyway, you fell. Here, let me give you a hand.
And he picks up his son, but unfortunately, you know, he sees the cat, and the cat's in really bad shape. So he does, I think, what he thinks is the best, and, you know, puts the cat out of his misery. He snaps his neck. And they walk back into the morgue room, and there's a small crematorium there, and they put the cat in there, and, you know, they set it on fire. They cremate it. So they continue. Oh, and by the way, while this was happening, before Tommy walked in, he cut himself with one of the ribs, right?
Yeah, while Austin was investigating that noise, Tommy continued his internal examination and he cut himself on one of the ribs. He cut his wrist. Thank you.
So they go on and they continue investigating, and now they're into the stomach. But before they get into the stomach, one of the drawers starts to open up, right?
Yeah, one of the drawers on the right side on the bottom starts to open up slowly. And Tommy's like,
ha! What are you doing over there? Are you peeking in there?
Oh, I must have just forgotten to close it, Dad.
Ha ha! You're a fool sometimes, Austin. Anyway, come over here. Look at this.
And they're popping the stomach open and they find this thing that turns out to be a paralyzing agent, Jimson weed, in her stomach. Now, this stuff is typically from the Northeast, and they are in Virginia, right?
Yeah, so, you know, now I think they decide that maybe she is, in fact, from the Northeast because they found peat, which, again, grows naturally in the Northeast, and now they found Jimson weed, which, again, grows naturally in the Northeast.
It's a long distance for a cadaver to travel, you know, from the northeast of Virginia. But yeah, I guess that's where we are now. And then suddenly the radio now starts talking about like what appears to be the storm of the century, right? And in local news, this is Tom Brokaw. I would suggest that you leave immediately because there's a storm of the century coming. Some experts are calling it the storm of the decade. Isn't the storm of the century more important than the storm of the decade? I mean, I don't know. I didn't write the script. It's Polly Johnson. Yes, so if you're anywhere near this area, we would suggest, this news report suggests that you leave immediately. And at this point, Tommy's really starting to get freaked out.
Yeah, Tommy really didn't want to be that to begin with. Like, he was hurrying some of the autopsy. Like, he just, when he made an accusation, he just wanted to leave already because his girlfriend was waiting.
Yeah, but now I think he wants to leave because he's starting to get scared.
Yeah, you're right. It's different reason, but yeah, he really didn't want to be there, but now he really wants to leave. They want to finish in the morning, I think he said.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And then Tommy's like,
ha! You want to leave? You want to get laid? Yeah, you go ahead. Get out of here. Leave. I'll do this. You want to go? Get out of here. Make like a tree and get out of here. I'll finish this up. I'll just put on my glory and we'll be good to go.
But alas, Austin stays because he wants to continue helping his dad. So the autopsy continued. And now, further explanation of the stomach renders a mysterious pouch. And they open up this pouch, and it turns out that it's this cloth with some kind of symbols. And inside this pouch, cloth, wrapped with the same type of string that they found in her throat, is her missing tooth. And this cloth has some kind of message on it. It's got Roman numerals and some crazy diagram. And at this point, Austin would like to make another accusation.
Dad, I have a theory.
All right, what you got?
I think somebody bound her. They ripped out her tongue. They poisoned her. They pulled out her tooth. They forced her to swallow her tooth. They paralyzed her. Somehow, they burned her internals. They sewed her back up, and she's dead here. How do you think?
Ha! You're a fool, Austin. This is why I'm the pathologist, and you're just a simple tech. I'm sorry, all right? But it's the truth. How do you suppose that they burned her on the inside? How? They I don't even know what kind of crazy... They stuck a mat down her ear or her stomach through her mouth or her nose and burned up the intestines? That's insane. Are you listening to yourself?
Well, I mean, that's your theory. I never said that.
But that's what you're suggesting. You're a fool, Austin. Impossible.
And then the radio warns again.
Oh, one thing is for sure, you're not going anywhere.
And then a creepy song starts to talk. A creepy song starts to play. It's all about the devil, and I learned who an angel. Now Austin really, really wants to go now. Austin's like, fuck, 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 fuck. He wants to go. You know, the creepy song, all that other shit. And then as this is happening, Tommy was slicing off her skin from her flesh. And he pulls off the skin and he realizes that internally she's been tattooed with the same symbols they found on that cloth that was inside her stomach. And suddenly, all the drawers now began to open slowly and the lights in the room suddenly explode. Bah! And everything is dark and smoky for a second, and everybody's confused. And when Tommy and Austin finally connect with each other, because Austin's like,
Dad, over here.
They realize that now all the corpses from those drawers are missing. Well, now finally, Tommy's like,
fuck this. I've never seen shit like this, but fuck it, let's get out of here.
So they make like a tree, and they get out of there. And they're walking towards the hallway and they try the elevator, but unfortunately, it's not working.
Of course.
Well, I mean, the power did go out. How do you expect the elevator to work?
Of course. The backup generator turns on, so there's some kind of electricity, but it is insufficient to power the elevator. I'm sorry, but it should be sufficient to power the elevator. Whose generator? Who installed this generator? But anyway, that's neither here from there or there. So they try the stairs.
Tommy attempts to pry the doors open.
Ah, damn it. It's the old sycamore. It's falling on top. Help. We're stuck.
And now they're stuck. And now they see some fucking crazy shit, lurking, like some zombie looking at another one of the corpses potentially. So they run their asses into the office. And thankfully, thankfully they make it. I don't know what I was going with that. But thankfully they make it. And thankfully there is a landline. Can you explain a landline to our listeners? Well, I mean, I think everybody knows what a landline is. Well, if you don't know what a landline is, Google it. It's like a cell phone, but with a line. So anyway, they try the landline and, Tommy begins to dial.
Hello, Popo, this is Tommy. We need your ass out here. All right, there's a problem.
And the other side can't hear.
Hello, I said this is Tommy. Put Burke on the line.
And Burke answers,
Tommy, we can't hear you.
Burke, it's Tommy. The sycamore fell and this crazy shit happening. You can get your ass out here now. The ambulances and everything and blankets and coffee and all that good stuff that we need so we can have a happy ending to this.
Tommy, you're cutting off.
Damn it. Damn it, Burke.
And so, of course, they can't hear. So he hangs up the phone. But Austin is staring intently at the door to the office, and he senses something and sees something interesting, so he crouches to look in the door, and he sees a foot with a tag, a toe tag, a corpse, and suddenly, it's banging. But thankfully, they both have the presence of mind to grab a file cabinet and move it towards the door. And they barricade the door, but shit, that shit is scary. So the door is barricaded now. And now, obviously, Tommy continues to bleed from his cut. So he decides to... Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord, I don't know how that happened. The Tommy... Intermission. Tommy goes to the restroom to clean his cut. And he's cleaning himself, and as he's walking back out, suddenly there's this shadowy thing in the curtain, and the door slams shut.
Ah!
And Tommy's trying to get the door open. Bah! 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 And he can't. I'm sorry. Austin's trying to get the door open, and he can. And Tommy's trapped in there, and finally gets the door open somehow, thankfully. And he finds Tommy there. Thankfully, Tommy's okay. He's just, a little shaken up, but there's bruises on him now. There's bruises. And now the door to the hallway is open. And the door to the restroom is open, but there's nothing there.
What the hell is going on here? Here, help me up. Thank you.
And he helps his dad up, and they make it, or rather they decide for some reason, that they're going to return to the autopsy room. Why did they decide to return to the autopsy room? I think at this point they don't know. They don't have any idea. They think that maybe the corpse is somehow keeping them there. Something mysterious is happening, but they've already tried the staircase, and that didn't work. And the elevator is obviously not power, so, I don't think they're working out a reason right now. So some weird shit is happening. So they're walking, and they're walking towards back to the examination room.
Okay, now, what the hell is this?
And now they see that some of the tissue that they pulled out of the cadaver has decomposed somehow.
Huh. Fascinating. Rapid decomposition. I've never seen anything like it. What's inside the body was keeping it alive, but now that it's outside, it's dead.
And just as this is happening, the doors behind him to the morgue closed. And Austin reacts immediately, and he goes and grabs the emergency axe and hacks through the door a couple times. Gah! Gah!
And through the slit that he created with the axe, he sees a figure.
Rah!
And it's that same woman who had her eyes and mouth closed. And now they're like really fucking freaked out. They have no idea what to do. And, you know, that thing is trying to get in. And they decide, very interestingly enough, well, I'm going to leave this to our special guest. Ladies and gentlemen, the sheriff from our episode on Pet Cemetery Bloodlines. Sheriff from Pet Cemetery Bloodlines, please come on in. Can you explain to us exactly what they are going to attempt to do at this particular instance in the movie?
Wait, I mean, the only thing that they can do right now is they gotta burn that corpse to the ground. That's the only way they can stop this thing from spreading. Now, I know what you're thinking. That's that sheriff who likes to burn shit down to the ground. But let me tell you, it's the best course of action to take. I know you got some matches around here because I saw him smoking. And this is the morgue, so I'm certain there's some flammable liquid in this son of a bitch. So we gotta burn that woman down to the ground. The only way you can contain it. I guarantee it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the sheriff from Pet Cemetery Bloodlines, thank you so much. And that's exactly what they do. They decide to burn that some bitch to the ground. And, you know, they set her on fire. They set her on fire. And she's burning. And suddenly the fire starts to spread all over the room. And thankfully, there's a fire extinguisher. But unfortunately, some of the fire captures the camera that they used to record the entire thing. Ugh. I think it's damaged, but I don't think it's destroyed. Anyway, suddenly the elevator turns back on. And Tommy and Austin run. Well, as much as they can, you know. They haste. Haste, Father. Haste towards the elevator. We'll be all right. We'll be fine just yet, Father. So Austin and Tommy rush, power walk to the elevator. Power walk, one, two. And they're in, but of course the doors don't close. Damn it! And Tommy panics. Austin panics because he sees the figure and it's walking towards them and the doors won't close. So Tommy grabs the axe from Austin and, like one of those axe throwing competitions, launches it. And suddenly the mystery looks like it's... The demon looks like it's contained and they step out. Only to see that the axe has struck Emma. Dad! Oh, Dad, Emma. You killed Emma, Dad. Unfortunately, Emma has been killed with the axe. And Tommy feels horrible, obviously, and Austin's just besides himself. You know, they're trying to escape, and suddenly Emma gets killed, and now it's just a really tragic situation, really, really fast, and really, really sad. So they continue, and there's a moment there where they're just looking at her, and they're wondering what to do. She had returned to meet Austin. But now they're, they're game planning. What will we do? What will we do now? Unfortunately, there's not much to do. So they return to the examination room because they're convinced that somehow that thing is possessed. And I don't know what they think it is right now. What do you think? I don't think the characters know either, but something creepy is definitely happening and they can't get to the bottom of it. So the best place they can do is just go back to the morgue. I don't know. Well, they return to the morgue once again. Well, the examination room, I should say. And there's one thing that they still haven't done. They haven't checked the brain. So they perform a procedure to remove the scalp. They cut the scalp. And then they use a saw, circular saw, to cut the skull open. And they pop the lid. They pop the lid. They remove the portion of the skull that they just and they grab a sample tissue from the brain. And Austin looks at it under a microscope.
Dad, it's alive! Look at this! Son of a bitch, it's alive! Well, it's too late to put it on the board. Damn it!
And suddenly they're just, I don't know what they're doing with the cloth or something. They're folding it when he removed the cloth from the microscope. He realizes that the markings refer to Leviticus 20:27. And now Leviticus 20:27 is a passage of the Bible, and it's not the same one. I read it. And the movie's a little different, but an actual passage of the Bible that says, a man or a woman who is a medium or spiritualist amongst you must be put to death. You are to stone them. Their blood will be on their hands. And there's also a date, the 17th century. And now they start to put it all together. Shit. Pete from the Northeast. 17th century. Markings. Oh my God. What? This can't be. Are we dealing with... She's from New England? Salem witch hunt? And they realize that maybe, just maybe, this woman was in fact a corpse from the 17th century from the Salem witch trials. A witch, potentially. Instead of, you know, I guess getting rid of this accused witch, which, by the way, Tommy initially doesn't buy.
It was mass hysteria. There was no such thing. It was just a bunch of innocent women who were accused of doing things they didn't really do. It's no different than shit people do nowadays.
Remember I told you about that spectral evidence stuff?
Yeah, I do remember. Can you explain to us the spectral evidence? Yeah, if I remember correctly, it was when you said that if somebody had a dream of another woman doing witch-like things like bewitching somebody's husband or flying or performing some kind of ritual, that was enough. A dream or a vision was enough to convict somebody potentially in spectral court of being a witch.
That's right. That's evidence. Spectral evidence. And so they theorize,
well, maybe because she was an innocent, they did all these crazy things with the markings and the swelling of the tooth, and they performed this ritual on her. Instead of actually getting rid of a witch and punishing her, they turned her into a witch.
But why us, Dad?
Oh, Tommy, there's no real reason why us. They just brought the corpse here. We just happened to be in her way. No real reason why. It's just the consequence. And frankly, we're probably the only ones that have ever seen any of this stuff before. Maybe, I don't know, maybe some other coroner has investigated her. I don't know. We don't really know her backstory, which, you know, would have been nice. But again, well, it is what it is. Put it on the board.
And now shit is getting real fucked up. And there's no way out. So Tommy realizes that maybe it's a curse, and maybe by sacrificing himself, somehow, you know, he can save Austin. And he whispers to the corpse.
All right, corpsey lady. Do what you will, but just save my son.
And then suddenly Tommy's ankles break.
Ah! My ankles!
And his wrist.
Ah! Ah! My wrist! Oh, shit! Shit, shit, shit!
And suddenly he starts showing all the wounds that the corpse had. At the same time, the wounds on this corpse are beginning to heal. And Tommy's in bad shape now.
Oh, shit. Give me that knife, Austin. I gotta end this.
And he's about to cut his tongue or something with that knife when suddenly, you know, he just sees his dad in too much pain. And Austin grabs that knife and just stabs him.
Dad. Austin. I'm dying. Lordy, Lord.
And Tommy tragically dies, unfortunately. And now they think, you know, he thinks that the whole ordeal is over. And thankfully, we hear Sheriff Burke.
Hi. Hey, Tommy, Austin, we're out here. Come on over here.
And Austin gets up and exits the morgue room and walks towards the staircase we saw earlier and tries to pry open the doors, which had the old sycamore fallen on top, but he can't open it.
And then he realizes that what he heard is probably not true, just another potential hallucination, right? And suddenly he turns around and he...
Ah! Dad! Ah!
Sees his dad and trips over the railing and falls to his death. And a tragic end for both Tommy and Austin and Emma and everybody that was in there that night. They wind up dead. And then we move on to the scene of the police arriving, unfortunately not with an ambulance and the coffee or a blanket with the sun shining in the background, but literally with more body bags. And they find that corpse again with no signs of trauma. And now the Burke's like, get this thing out of here.
Take her to VCU, Virginia Commonwealth. I want her out of my county.
And as they're taking Jane Doe's body, the radio changes again. See that song about the devil? Or some Let the song about the devil.
And suddenly the corpse moves her toe. Ah! And that's it. It's over.
And what a wild ride. What an enjoyable film, frankly. I mean, it really was. A really freaking tragic ending. Really, really hated it, unfortunately. But overall, really well done. Really, really appreciate how meticulous they were in examining. It was like a murder mystery horror movie. Like a real murder mystery. Not like A Haunting in Venice. This was a real murder mystery that I enjoyed. And you know what? I loved it. I thought it was a great film. Great story. Great acting. Great music. Great everything. You know, the ending I hated. Hated it. But overall, I enjoyed it. I give this an 8 out of 10.
8 out of 10
for The Murder of Jane Doe, or The Autopsy of Jane Doe. I keep saying The Murder of Jane Doe.
If you're still here, thanks for joining us on another exciting episode of Rick's Rated R Horror Movie Review Show, and we'll catch you next time.